Hey everyone, I'm Ruben, the project steward of Firo, and today I want to talk about a critical issue that affects the entire cryptocurrency space, especially proof of work coins, and that issue is chain security. Recently, there's been a lot of discussion about Monero and the actions of a project called Qubic. The situation has been widely reported, often with sensational headlines about a 51% attack. As a project that has dealt with these exact challenges, I want to offer a factual breakdown of what happened, what it means for proof of work, and how different projects, including our own, are building more robust security models for the future. So let's start with the facts. Qubic is a separate blockchain project that also runs a mining pool. They devise a strategy to attract Monero miners. How? By creating an economic model that, on the surface, offered miners significantly higher profits to mine Monero through their system than you could get by mining Monero directly. And the way this was supposed to work was that Monero mined by their pool would be sold for stablecoins. Those stablecoins would then be used to buy back and burn Qubic's own token, creating deflationary pressure and driving up its price. And this rising token price was then used to subsidize the reward paid out to Qubic miners. In essence, the model relied on the appreciation of their own asset to pay for the hash rate being directed at Monero. However, it's important to note that these claims of selling Monero for buybacks are just that, claims. Qubic disabled this public API, making it impossible for outside observers to independently verify their hash rate. Also, due to Monero's private nature, there isn't a credible way to verify that these buy and burn operations were actually happening as described. This economic incentive, whether real or perceived, was effective, and a significant amount of Monero's hash rate moved to the Qubic run pool. And this concentration of mining power led to a period of network instability for Monero, which included a 6-block chain reorganization. And what this means is that 6 previously confirmed blocks were invalidated and replaced by an alternative chain, a rare and concerning event. And to make matters worse, the Qubic run pool was observed intentionally mining empty blocks. This is a disruptive act as it processes no transactions and it actually reduces the pool's own profitability. This suggests that the goal wasn't just profit, but to create maximum disruption to support their claims of a successful attack. And the impact on the ecosystem was immediate and serious. Several major exchanges and services reacted to the perceived risks, and most notably, Kraken temporarily paused Monero deposits as a security precaution, citing the concentration of mining power. And there were also reports that withdrawals were disabled on most other major centralized exchanges as well. This is the most important question and the one that has been widely misreported even by the crypto media, such as CoinDesk, without any independent verification done on their end. Was this a successful 51% attack? The evidence suggests it was not. First, the claim that Qubic control over 51% of the hash rate comes from their own self-reported data, and it should be disputed. In fact, on-chain analysis suggests that their actual share of the network hash rate was significantly lower, peaking around 28-35%, though still large enough to cause disruptions. The Riyadh Institute, an independent research institute specializing in privacy and cybersecurity, published a report that also proves that Qubic was misrepresenting its hash rate, which you can read in the link below. And second, and most critically, the goal of a malicious 51% attack is almost always to execute a double spend, to steal funds by reversing a confirmed transaction. Despite the chain reorganization, there have been no verified double spends on the Monero network from this incident. The chain reorganization was likely the result of a strategy called selfish mining, where a pool with a large, but not necessarily majority, share of the hash rate can gain a disproportionate number of blocks by strategically withholding them from the rest of the network before publishing them all at once. A true sustained 51% attack would give an entity the power to perform reorganizations of any depth, not just six blocks, at will, which was not demonstrated here. The entire event appears to have been an elaborate marketing campaign by Qubic, using an economic model with Ponzi-like elements to generate publicity at Monero's expense. And this incident is a powerful illustration of a challenge that all pure proof-of-work coins face. The original security assumption was that miners are invested in the long-term health of the coin that they mine. However, the landscape has changed, and what we now see are mercenary mining, where miners are economically rational actors who will direct their hardware to whichever coin offers the most profit in dollar terms. Qubic's strategy proved that a network security budget can be overcome by a competitor with a more aggressive economic incentive model, even if it's not sustainable in the long term. And this is a challenge we at Firo know firsthand. Back in 2021, when Firo was a pure proof-of-work coin, we also suffered a 51% attack where someone rented what was equivalent to 50,000 GPUs to perform an attack that reversed a day's worth of blocks. This was done actually shortly before our own hybrid proof-of-work and chainlock systems was meant to activate, which would have been prevented the attack, as we had really early on identified pure proof-of-work's fragility. And Firo isn't alone in being 51% attacked. Ethereum Classic, Bitcoin Gold, Horizon, Bitcoin SV, and even fellow privacy coins Grin and Beam too have been 51% attacked with deep reorganizations. Our experience and their experience has taught us that relying on hash rate alone is not enough. And that's why we implemented a hybrid system that combines proof-of-work with a second layer of security provided by masternodes. And we call the system LLMQ, or Long-Lived Masternode Quorum Chain Locks, which we adopted from Dash that pioneered this consensus mechanism. And here's how it works. First of all, you have a proof-of-work layer, and proof-of-work miners still create blocks. This retains the key benefits of proof-of-work: a fair and permissionless distribution of new coins to anyone who wants to participate. Then we add a second layer of security consisting of masternodes. To run a masternode, an operator must lock up 1,000 Firo as collateral, giving them skin in the game and a strong incentive to protect the network. Now, when a miner finds a block, a large randomly selected group of these masternodes, are actually 400 of these masternodes, must vote to confirm it. And once a supermajority agrees, they issue a chain lock which makes that block instant and permanently final. This creates a two-factor security system. To attack Firo, an adversary would need to control over 50% of the mining hash rate and compromise a majority of the masternode network at the same time, a task that is exponentially more expensive and difficult to execute. It actually also creates finality where, you know, once you have one confirmation, or even before the confirmation is found, you know that your transactions are not going to be double spent. Now, the Monero community is now having a very important public discussion about its own path forward. And Monero Research is actively exploring several potential solutions. Let's look at two of these proposals. First is the trailing finality layer, or TFL, and it's a sophisticated proposal to add a proof-of-stake-like security layer that runs on top of Monero's existing proof-of-work chain. In this system, a group of validators would periodically vote to finalize a block from the recent past, so it has some similarity to the masternode system. Once a block is finalized, it and all the blocks before it become irreversible. The main advantage is resilience. If the finality layer ever stalls, the main proof-of-work chain just keeps running without interruption. But the trade-off is that finality is delayed. Unlike the masternode system, it's not instant. As it says, it's a trailing finality layer, and it adds quite a bit of protocol complexity. Now, the second proposal involves changing the mining protocol to combat pool centralization. This is an approach that targets the root cause of the problem, large centralized mining pools. And the idea is to change Monero's mining algorithm random acts so that creating new work for miners requires accessing random parts of the blockchain itself, and to do this much more frequently. Now, the advantage is that for a solo miner running a full node, this is a minor change, but for a centralized pool, it would dramatically increase their bandwidth costs, as they would have to constantly send huge amounts of data to their thousands of miners, and makes it much more expensive to run a centralized pool, while encouraging miners to use decentralized alternatives like P2P. But this solution is not without its, you know, trade-offs. There are questions about its effectiveness, whether it would actually discourage smaller miners, and whether this proposal is actually viable at all. And if you want to read more, you can check out Monero's research GitHub at the link below. Now, just to summarize, the events surrounding Monero was a serious network disruption, but the claims of a successful 51% attack are not supported by the evidence. No funds were stolen. What this incident does is highlight the industry-wide challenge for pure proof-of-work cryptocurrencies. Security is no longer just about the cryptography, it's also about the economic incentives. At Firo, we address this by evolving to a hybrid system with chain locks. The Monero community is now carefully considering its next steps, and this is how decentralized projects are supposed to work. They face challenges, they debate openly, and they adapt to become stronger. So what do you think is the best path forward for securing proof-of-work networks? Let me know in the comments below. And, you know, thanks for watching. If you found this explanation helpful, please give it a like and subscribe for more factual analysis on the crypto privacy space.